I want to talk about temptation. I want to talk about temptation and the source of all temptation. The source of all temptation comes from the world, the flesh, and the devil. Amen? There's three ways that people deal with temptation. The first way, go for it. Just do it. The second way is you try to resist it and fight it in your own strength. And the third most successful way is you fight it in the name of Jesus. Amen? The Word of God says, resist the devil and he will Many know these verses. Many of us know these verses. Resist the devil and he will flee. But a lot of us know the verses but don't exercise the verses. They know the verses, they know what it says, but they just know it mentally and they don't exercise what they know. Amen? When temptation comes, they're not resisting, they're not holding back. They just go for it. Amen? Well, God has a purpose for you. And you need to live your life like Jesus could come back at any moment. We all know it's the end days. Jesus could come back at any moment, so we have to live like he can pop up at any moment. And we need to be ready and be caught resisting the devil. Amen? So you can no longer go on falling for the same old lines of the devil. You can no longer go on falling for the same things of the world. You can no longer go falling for the desires of your flesh. And you can no longer be falling for the same old tricks of the devil. Amen? We all know his tricks. We all know what he does. And yet we still fall for it. Amen? We all know that the devil is here to steal, kill, and destroy you. The devil hates you. The devil, he's your enemy. And he's planning to defeat you daily. He's willing to invest any amount of time it takes to see you going down. He has tricks. He has strategies. He has tactics. And his favorite weapon to use on us is temptation. Amen? Satan wants to tempt you into sin today. Because sin will break your fellowship with God. It'll break down the communication between you and God. And broken fellowship with God is the worst thing that can happen to any child of God. I told you before that the most miserable person in the world ain't the person that's lost and doesn't know God. The worst miserable person in the world is the one that knows God and is out of fellowship. The person that doesn't know God, he's not miserable. He has no conviction. He goes on doing his sin, evil deeds, and he's all right with it. He can sleep at night, wake up and do it again. But the person who's of God, and they're living in sin, they're going to live a miserable life. Amen? They're caught between two worlds, the natural world and the spiritual world, and they're constantly battling within themselves because one part of them is saying, don't do that. That's the Spirit of God in you because you're saved. And the other side saying, yeah, come on. Let's do it. So there's a battle going on. Amen? Satan wants you to sin. He wants you to fall for his temptation because he wants to make you miserable. After Satan gets you sin, guess what he does? He accuses you. He slanders you. He blames you. He points the finger at you. Satan uses these types of strategies and tactics to defeat the children of God. His game always begins with temptation. Now Satan knows that he can never have your soul because you're saved. God owns you now. Amen? He can never have your soul. But he also knows that if he can cause you to give in to temptation, then you will become powerless. And then you will become useless as a child of God. Because if he can get you to sin and you go off into temptation And now your testimony ain't worth nothing. Now you can't do anything for the kingdom because you're sinning when you're not supposed to. Amen? Satan loves to see the children of God living in defeat. Satan loves to see you living without victory. God says you have the victory because you have Jesus. But if you're not in fellowship with Jesus and you're falling for temptation left and right, then you are going to live below God's standard, living in defeat, living under victory. You ain't going to shine for Jesus. Amen? Satan loves nothing better than to cause one of his children to fall into sin. Satan will tempt you. He will show you mud. He will trap you in the mud. He'll trip you and cause you to fall into the mud. He will trap you and cover you with the mud. And then he will jump on your back while you're in the mud. Amen? And then he'll stand up and accuse you of being dirty. Ain't he a dirty dog? Amen? He's the one that got you in the mud. He's the one that jumped on you in the mud. He's the one that tripped you in the mud, trapped you in the mud, got the mud on you. And then you'll tell God, look, that's your child that you saved. That's your child that you bled for. And look at how he repays you by playing in the mud. Look at him all dirty. Look at him all filthy. Look at him in sin. Look at him in defeat. That's your child, God. That's a terrible place to be, amen? Bringing shame and dishonor and disgust to the word Jesus, to the name of Jesus, amen? That's right, that's the way he plays his game. His rules, there is no rules. Temptation cannot be avoided. Temptation will come into every life. And your job is not to fight temptation in your own strength. Jesus has done that. You can overcome temptation by the power of Jesus Christ. Amen? When temptation arises in your life, don't just give in to it. Don't be one of those people who says, well, if it feels good, then do it. You only live once. It only comes around one time. Have your fun. Have your cake. And eat it too. Amen? You'll never get a chance like this again. This only happens once in a lifetime. Do it. You can repent later. God will forgive you. He's a loving God, remember? He forgives everybody. He'll accept you back. The devil lying in one ear and God in the other ear saying, don't do it. Amen? That's right. You must resist the devil. Don't fight him in your own strength. If you do, you will fall. You will fail. Amen? Over and over again. Because no one can overcome temptation on their own strength. On your own, you don't have the power to defeat temptation. And we do that. Either we go for it or we fight. Oh, I can't do that. I can't do that. I better not do that. I better not do this. And we're fighting in our own. And then when we fail, we get, oh, well, I can't, man. I can't stop. I can't do it. I'm weak. That's right. You are. And every time you try to fight temptation on your own strength, you're going to fail. It says it in the book. Amen? The only way you're going to defeat temptation is to give it all to Jesus. Amen? That's right. When you give it to him and say, Lord, I can't stop. Lord, I'm tempted. Give it to him. The Bible says that give every thought, take every thought captive to Jesus. A lot of times, my preacher used to say that sin is like a motion picture, a movie. You go watch a movie, you don't know all what's in it until you see it, right? So you don't know what's going to pop up on the screen in front of you. And it pops up, whoa, hey, and then just let it go by, just like a movie. But a lot of times we go push, pause, rewind, slow, whoa. Amen? The motion picture's running, you can't stop what your eyes are going to see. It's rolling. You go through life, you're looking, your eyes are looking everywhere. You can't stop what you're looking at. You're going to see it. But you can't stop from doing a triple take. You know what I'm saying? See, you got to let that picture just sail on by, just like a thought. You gotta just let it. You can't stop the devil from flinging arrows into your mind, but you don't have to stop, rewind, slow-mo. Just let it go through as fast as it came. Let it go through. When you stop to focus on it, that's when you're giving the devil some room. Amen? Don't fight him on your own strength. If you do, you're going to fail. The only way to overcome temptation is through the power of Jesus. Jesus has power over temptation, and because of Jesus, so do you. Amen. If I fight temptation in the name of Jesus, I'm a victor. Amen? Amen? So verse 13 says, again, no temptation has overtaken you except such as common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you're able to withstand. But with the temptation will also make the way of escape that you may be able to bear it. So don't think that your temptation is greater than mine, or my temptation is greater than yours. We all face the same kind of temptations from the same places. We all get the same temptations from the same sources. They are three primary sources of temptation. It's up there. The world, the flesh, and the devil. Those are the three main primary sources of which people can be tempted by. Amen? That's right. And these three attack the children of God on a daily basis. He combo mixes them. He gives one today, one tomorrow. If they don't work, he'll combo mix them together. And if that don't work, he'll flip it the other way. But it's always the same three, just in a different setup, coming at you daily. The world, the flesh, and the devil. Let me explain. The world. In the Bible, the world, the word for world means a system or an order. The Bible says that this system or order called the world, the Bible said, is evil. And 1 John 2:15 says, do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. James 4:4, don't you know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Brothers and sisters, you can become so worldly that you can fail to stand out for God. You're doing the things that the world's doing, falling for the things of the world and the things that are in it, the riches, the gold, the money, the houses, the cars, the clothes, the name, the power, the influence. All this is things of the world. Amen? You are to be different, the Bible says. You're supposed to be distinct. You're a set apart people for God's glory. Amen? You are not to allow this world to force you into their mold. Romans 12:2 says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. We're not to be conformed to the things of this world, do what they're doing, act like they act, go where they go. We're supposed to be transformed and be different, set apart from God's kingdom. Amen? Secondly, we have the flesh. Our flesh is born into a world of sin. There is a leaning in our nature to sin, because we are born into a world of sin. This flesh wants to sin, so we lean towards sin whenever it pops up naturally. That's your natural state of mind, to be a sinner. Amen? When you are born again, you are born into a new nature. Not the nature of sin, but the nature of God. Now you have two natures living inside you, the spirit and the flesh. You have the flesh already, and then when you accept Christ, you're born of the spirit, and now God lives in you. So now you have the flesh, and now you have the spirit, both living inside of you, and And guess what's happening? They are fighting. Your flesh still wants to do the old things that Marcos used to want to do. And the spirit wants to do the things of God. So now you're fighting within yourself. Amen? That's right. That's right. When you are born again, you are born into the spirit, the nature of God. Now you have two. So now there's a war going on. I already said that. Amen? And the verse is Galatians 5:17. It says, for the flesh lusts against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things that you wish to do. So see, now you got the flesh, and now you got the spirit. They're contrary to one another. They're fighting each other. So now you don't get to do what you want to do. You get to do one of those things is running your life this morning. Amen? One of these two is in control. Either the flesh or the Spirit of God is running your life. Amen? When we fall into sin, we always try to blame someone or something or even God. We're like, well, God is in control of everything, right? Why did he let this happen? Why did he let sin? God's tempting me. God's testing me. God is making me do this. This is a temptation from God. Well, that's a lie from the pit of hell. James 1:13 says, let no one say when he is tempted, I am tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he himself tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when he is drawn away and enticed by his own evil desires. Our own evil desires is what drags us away, and we say, oh, well, God, you control. God already had it written. He knows my whole life before I did it. So I don't have to do anything. God is already going to know if I'm going to accept him or not, so why do anything? You know what I'm saying? So we get drawn away by our own desires, and that is called the desires of the flesh. Temptation comes from the world, the flesh, and the devil. So our own temptation, it would drive us away. The devil doesn't have to work so hard to get us to sin. He doesn't come that hard. He just mentions it, and we're like, oh, yeah. We're already, our own desire wants to do it. So all he has to do is just mention something. He doesn't really have to try that hard. We think, oh, he's going to come out. He comes back like an angel of light, the Bible says. He comes as something beautiful, something that looks harmless. But that's how he gets you. Amen? Verse 13 of our passage has good news. It says, but God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able. He will make a way of escape, a way of bearing it. So when temptation comes, don't think, oh, I can't resist. Oh, I can't say no. It says right here that God's already made a way of escape. God's already made it to where you're able to hold to it. God's already made a way where you don't have to fall. Amen? He says to he can bear it. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you're able. So when that temptation comes, the Bible says you're able to say no. If you're in Christ Jesus, because you got the power with you, say no. But at the time, we don't want to use it. We're like, well, maybe I won't say no to this. You know what I mean? Maybe I won't say no to that. But God says you got the power. Don't act like you can't do it. Don't act like you're powerless. Don't act like you can't say no. You got the power of my name. You can say no. I gave you the ability. I gave you what you need to do it. So it's our own flesh that tempts us into sin. Blessed is the man. Blessed is the woman who takes that way out. Who takes the way of Jesus. Amen. James 1:12. Blessed is the man who endures temptation. For when he has been approved and tested, he will receive the crown of life which the Lord has promised to those who love him. Amen. Blessed are you if you endure temptation. You'll get the crown. You'll get the crown of life. if you take that way of escape. Amen? And then lastly, the devil. His main objective, as far as you are concerned, is to cause you to fall so that God is dishonored and you become useless in the kingdom work of God. The devil knows that he can never have your soul. You are God's, bought and paid for with his blood. Permanently, he purchased you. You belong to him now, right? But he can't take you, but the devil knows that he can get you to sin. Then you'll dishonor God and discredit God, and you will be useless to God. Amen? If you're falling into sin, who are you going to tell about God? You're going to be like, well, weren't you over there doing this? Who are you to tell me? Amen? The devil knows that. The devil knows every weakness you have. And he exploits those weaknesses, trying to get you to sin. He knows you real good. He don't know you like God. God knows you inside and out. But the devil knows you like your mama or your daddy that raised you knows you. He watched you grow up from a little baby. The devil's had his eye on you from when you were born. And he watches you. He sees what color is your favorite color. He sees what's your favorite treat. He sees what your favorite dessert is. He pretty much knows what you, like your mom knows when you're lying to her. Because they just know. Mothers don't lie, amen? You can't lie to your mom, and if she just lets you because she don't want to deal with it, she'll just like, yeah, yeah, you're playing me, whatever. But they know you that well. But your mama doesn't know your mind or your heart, but she knows your habits, she knows your likes, she knows your dislikes. She raised you. She knows when you're lying. She knows where you're going to go. She knows what your habits are. And that's how the devil, he knows you in that kind of way. So he can put your favorite food out there, your favorite likings, and get you to sin. Because he's watched you grow. He's seen your habits. He knows what you're about. And he can get you to sin if he just exercises these things. Amen? He tells you how great sin will be in 1 year. Sin will be good. He tells you that sin, that you'll get away with it. That you even deserve it. Because you've been good for so long. You've been serving the Lord. I'm good. Probably not. Been good. I've been going to church. I've been doing all these things. Ain't one little party ain't gonna hurt. One little slip up. I deserve it. I've been doing good. And he tells you that you deserve it and that everything will be alright and you can repent later. But the truth is the devil hates you. And he's plotting to see you go down. He's plotting your defeat. He's setting the trap out there. The snare is already there, waiting for you to step in it. The noose is there. Put your neck in it. It'll be okay. It won't hurt. You're sticking your neck in there. One verse in the Bible says that the devil fools us like a nose ring in an ox. That's how they pull them. A nose ring in the ox will fool you. And the ox is going, getting led to the slaughterhouse. The ox don't know where he's going. He's just going. But he's going to the slaughterhouse to get killed. And that's what the devil does. He puts that ring in our nose and pulls us. And we go for it, and we go for it, not knowing that he's taking you to death. He's taking you to the slaughterhouse. He's taking you to your demise. Amen? Mm-hmm. And we're like, yeah, smells good. Cinnamon. Amen? And most of you know what I'm talking about, deep. But he'll use whatever he can. And we're easy prey for the devil. Amen? That's right, verse 10:10. The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus has come to give you life and more abundantly. Amen? The devil wants to tempt you into sin so that he can accuse you before the Father. Point his finger at you. Amen? Revelation 12 says that Satan is the accuser of the brethren. That means the brethren is the same people. The brothers in Christ. The devil is the accuser of the brethren who accuses you before the Father day and night. Satan loves to point at you when you fall into sin, and he laughs at you before God as he's standing there accusing you. Is this your boy? Is this him? And he's laughing at you and just making it worse. Amen? That's right, brothers and sisters. So don't give Satan that satisfaction. Don't allow Satan to tempt you into sin. Don't allow the world, the flesh, and the devil to tempt you into dishonoring the Lord Jesus Christ. And in the world, again, is the tempter of your soul. The world says to your soul, you need more. You deserve more. Go out and get more. Amen. And the flesh refers to the old nature, and it tempts your body with laziness, lust, overindulgence, sex, the desires of the flesh. Your flesh said, I want some of that. I like it. I gotta give you some. I gotta go, yeah. See, or I'm lazy. I don't want to work. I want to relax. There's all kinds of fleshly temptations. I'll stay at home. And then you don't do them, you become lazy. Become the Bible calls them sluggards. And then the devil, he tempts the spirit. He's in the spiritual temptation because it's in the spirit that we know God. It's in the spirit that we worship God. It's in the spirit where we communicate with God. Amen. John 4:24 says, God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. So we worship and communicate and fellowship with God in the spiritual realm. And Satan hates that fellowship. So he wars against the spirit in an effort to cut off that fellowship with God. So he tempts your spirit. Satan attacks the spirit by placing doubts in your mind. He places false doctrine in your mind to turn you away from the truth. Ain't that something? The world tests you one way, the flesh another way, and Satan is all about the spiritual world. He tempts you in that realm. And like I said, he tempts you by putting wrong thoughts in your mind, making you not believe the word, giving you false doctrines, giving you partial truth, and slipping in the lie. And then you're off, already thinking something that's not even in the Bible because we don't need it. We just believe the preacher. Whatever I say, that's what it is. But you got to check me. You got to read this Bible and make sure I'm giving you the word of God. Amen? Because the Satan is slick. He can slip in anytime. So you can't run away from Satan. But you can drive them away. And the way you drive them away is by resisting. No, you have no authority here, Satan. You got feet. I'm going to do what Jesus wants me to do. It's the hard road, but it's the most beneficial road. It's the road with the victory road. That's the road we want to be on. That's right, brothers and sisters. Satan doesn't fear you. He ain't afraid of you. You don't do nothing to scare Satan away. But Satan is afraid of the blood of the Lamb. James 2:19 says, you believe that there's one God? You do well. Even demons believe and tremble. So you want to stand up to Satan in your own strength? He ain't afraid of you. But if you come with the blood, I'm covered in the blood. Jesus is here, the Lamb of God. Then he has to tuck tail. I will never tell you to go and fight Satan. He's a lot stronger than you. We just read the verse last week. He prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Lions are more powerful. Lions are more bigger. Lions can do some damage. You can't compete against a lion. But if you bring the name of Jesus, he doesn't have a chance. Amen? That's right. Right, temptation comes from the world, the flesh, and the devil, and it comes to every one of us. I know today that if you're a Christian, and if you are breathing, you're battling every day. The person that says, oh, I don't get no temptation, I'm strong, I don't stand, I'm perfect. The devil is in your ass right now, in your donkey. But anyway, your greatest resource in the face of temptation is a clergy, whatever trial. whatever temptation, you need to bring it all to Jesus. Because Jesus has already conquered the world, the flesh, and the devil. He's already got the victory over it. He's already defeated it. He's got the victory, and then we come to Jesus, we have the victory as well. Amen? So think about that. We need to set our minds on things above and not on things of the earth. We need to gird up our loins, meaning have your mind prepared for action and set your mind on things of what the Lord's doing. Amen? And I'll leave you with the last verse I just said. 1 Peter 5:8, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. That's a good line. Be sober, be vigilant, because the devil, as soon as we're not sober and we're not looking out, pop! Stuff begins to happen, amen? And we all know that's true. As soon as our mind ain't fixed on Jesus and we just overindulge ourselves in things, the devil is not absent. He's right there lurking. As soon as you go off into the gravel and off the main road, the devil's there waiting. Waiting to just say, yeah, come on. I'm your friend. Come on. Let's do it. And then we do it, and we're off into the woods. Amen? Just going to give God glory.